Yeah, I can start somewhere.
Okay. Good evening, dear members, speakers, members from overseas chapters and other dignitaries. Welcome to today's knowledge series session, Reimagining ESOPs, the journey from the entrepreneurs themselves. Let me now invite CA Sanjay Singh Panwar, our Vice Chairman, to share some exciting things about today's event.
Thank you, Somnath. Good evening to all members, speaker of the today's session, our overseas friends and their families. We welcome you all on one of the most interesting topic, employee stock option. Henry Ford famously said that a business that makes nothing but money is a poor business. As a business, our responsibility begins with our people, that is our employee. After all, a happy, trained, engaged, and motivated team will help you grow your business multifold. So stock options are an extremely popular method of attracting, motivating, and retaining employees, especially when the company is unable to pay the high salaries. On the emotional part also, the stock option permits employee to share in the company's success story also. As we had recently heard about the how this Flipkart employees become multi-millionaire or millionaire overnight after Walmart acquisition of that company. And considering this trend across the world, and especially in India, the stock option scenario will be on the rise. To unlock many more mysteries, complexities around employee stock option, let's hear and explore more about this topic from our expert speaker on that. So now I would request Shweta Singhal Verma to introduce our speaker of the day and take the session forward. Over to you, Shweta, now.
Thank you, Sanjay. A very good evening to everyone. In our today's knowledge series event, we have our members as our guest speakers, Mr. Lakshman Gupta, Mr. Vikram Sivaraman, and Ms. Prachi Vallikar, who will impart us some knowledge on the various aspects of ESOPs and other related challenges which startups have to deal with. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce our speakers today. Our first speaker is Mr. Lakshman Gupta. Mr. Lakshman is COO and co-founder of Capita. He has more than 20 years of experience in corporate venture capital and business development across many countries in Asia. His role in Capita is to provide equity management tools like ESOPs, cap table management, and liquidity solutions for startups. He specializes in founding and scaling startups, corporate venture, capital investment management, corporate finance, merger and acquisition, corporate structuring, corporate strategy, business development, treasury and taxation, boards and audit committees, among others. Mr. Lakshman has worked with popular brands such as Unilever, Discovery, Sony, Tata, and Astro. He is a chartered accountant and ICAW from India and holds an MBA degree from Indian School of Business. We have another speaker with us today, Mr. Vikram Sivaraman, who is colleague of Mr. Lakshman. And he will be telling us more about the challenges which startups have to deal with. Mr. Vikram has more than 12 years of experience, primarily in investment banking. He has advised on funding and merger and acquisition transactions worth $800 million. Mr. Vikram is the country head India of Capita. Prior to Capita, he was the CFO at India's leading rural e-commerce startup. He has previously worked with Spark Capital and Citigroup Global Markets. Mr. Vikram is passionate about working with and solving problems for founders and startups. He is a chartered accountant rank holder and holds an MBA degree from IIM Ahmedabad. Our third speaker is Ms. Prachi Vallikar, who is the product head Capita. Ms. Prachi has more than 17 years of experience in ESOP Direct. She is an expert in ESOP administration, valuation, and accounting. She has conceptualized and rolled out products in the ESOP and insider trading domain. She handles ESOPs of listed companies like Infosys, Kotak, etc., and large private companies like Flipkart. She is a chartered accountant rank holder and CPA from USA. She also holds a USA-based degree in certified equity professional. Let's welcome all our speakers for our today's knowledge series. Mr. Lakshman, may I invite you to start with today's event?
Okay. Thanks, Kala. Thanks, Somnath. Thanks, Sanjay,
Thanks, Shita, for all the intros. We are quite, thanks all for your time. We are all quite excited to be here and share our thoughts about ESOPs and also share how various aspects have evolved over a period of time. We have a short presentation which we'll take through 10 to 15 slides where Vikram, Prachi and I will take through various sections. If there are any questions, you're free to interrupt, but also we have a good time for Q&A at the end. Quite a few members and organizing committee also requested to give some backstory of how I started from being working from corporates and being and turned to be an entrepreneur, and how I started Capita to start in this equity management space and digitizing ESOPs. So I'll start off with that, and then we'll start off the presentation and give you some backstory about Capita. So I think earlier, as Kala mentioned, I am based out of Singapore for last 6 years. I am from Vijayawada, Andhra. I did my CA and ICW from in Vijayawada. Interesting bits to share is that my wife is a chartered accountant. I have a twin brother. I'm Lakshman, there is a Ram. So we are identical twins. So we both did CA and ICW together. And we also actually joined the same company in CA campus interviews in Chennai. And then we moved from different companies from there. And in my immediate family, I have 10 chartered accountants. At least my wife has 10 chartered accountants. So we're a family of chartered accountants. So whatever you do in life, first do chartered accountancy and then move ahead in life. That's a typical thing in our family. Coming to my career, after my CA, I joined immediately quickly into Hindustan Lever. I started in the plantation division in Valparai near Coimbatore. It was an interesting experience. From there, I went to Discovery Channel in Delhi, whereas in the finance division there. And then after working for 4 years, took a break to do my MBA from ISB. And after ISB, I moved to the corporate development when business development roles, did some stints in both Sony Entertainment and Tata Communications in Bombay. After that, got an opportunity to move to Malaysia. I joined Astro, a Malaysia-based media group, as head of corporate finance and head of investments. So at an young age of 32, 33, I became head of corporate finance and head of investments for a listed company, and then built up the fund, a corporate venture fund for almost $1 billion fund, where we invested across 25 startups, across Southeast Asia, invested across India, across US, UK and Australia. So worked with entrepreneurs for 10 years, over a period of 10 years, been on the boards of audit committees of these companies, wrote checks of around $5 million to $200 million and scaled up those startups. So it was a very good journey. So my entrepreneur association started with working with the startups as an investor primarily. As I was finishing 10 years in Astro and worked with entrepreneurs, I thought, okay, now I've reached the middle of my career. In the corporates, let second half be an entrepreneurship life. So decided to take the entrepreneurship plunge. Then I was exploring various ideas at that point of time, was exchanging thoughts with my co-founder now and CEO, Ravi. He was an investment banker. He was an investment banker for 17 plus years. We both worked 15 years back in Tata, so we were in touch from then. And both of us had similar thing that, okay, now half of the career has been spent in corporates, let's do something in entrepreneurship, and decided to take an entrepreneurship plunge. And we said that let's do something entrepreneurship where we have our expertise and where we can bring value. And one aspect, I was an investor, Ravi was an investment banker. And we said that various aspects of the investment banking have been, various aspects of banking has been digitized or disrupted, payments, lending, remittances. But one aspect which has not been disrupted is investment banking or advisory business. It is still a people-driven and an advisory-led thing. So we said that is a major aspect, which there's a big opportunity in bringing digitization in that aspect. So we explored various business models of how to bring digitization in this advisory business and in this investing. We looked at various business models like deal platforms and stuff. But what we realized is that these deal platforms are never scaled, whether it's in US or in Asia. At that time, when we were evaluating, we came across a couple of companies. One is Kata, another is Solium in US. Whereas this is where it comes linked to the ESOPs, actually. Solium is a 20-year-old company based out of Canada. They specialize only bringing digitization in ESOPs. They do for ESOP digitization, both for startups and also for the listed entities. And they've got sold for around $800 million, and it was acquired by Morgan Stanley. Now it's part of Morgan Stanley. It's called ShareWorks. So what Morgan Stanley looked in ShareWorks or the Solium is that the ESOP holders are the next wealth holders. Earlier, the future is that whoever has ESOPs, they are the multimillionaires, and we need to catch them at the end from the thing, and then we should take them. So actually, the Morgan Stanley Wealth Management acquired the Solium rather than the Morgan Stanley Investment Banking Division. Then Kata, which other company, which is based out of San Francisco, they came up with an interesting model. They brought digitization both on ESOP and also cap table as a complete linked product, because ESOP affects cap table. Because as you get vested exercise, the cap table will keep on changing. So they built an integrated product. And Goldman Sachs and Andreessen Horowitz, one a banker and one a popular VC, both of them invested $300 million around the time when we were looking. We saw that, okay, this is something which is getting attention of digitization of ESOPs, is bringing attention from both an investment bank and also a VC. So then we looked at the space, what they're bringing. So we thought this is something, digitization in ESOPs is something very big happening. So let's bring that space, that thing in this part of the world. For us, this part of the world is Southeast Asia and India. And actually the problem is much larger here, because at least in US shares are digitized, there's a digitization, but in Southeast Asia and India, still it's physical share certificates, ESOPs are managed on Excel sheets. And we felt that, okay, the startup ecosystem is rapidly developing in India and Southeast Asia. Just to give some numbers, some of you may be familiar. There, between India and Southeast Asia, there are now 25,000 funded startups. There are more than 70,000-80,000 startups, but the number of funded startups are around 25,000, which are VC funded. And if you wider Southeast Asia and India, it's 40,000. And any statistic is that there'll be 100,000 funded startups in India and Southeast Asia, and all of them require, and all of them are managing these ESOPs and all in a Excel sheets. And there's no, and employees also are seeing it in a very, very haphazard manner. So we thought we'll bring digitization in this aspect. So that's how we started. So we started Capita in 2019, three co-founders, Ravi and me, and one tech co-founder. Now we are a 52-member team. We were 6 people 7-8 months back. Now we've recruited almost 40 plus people in the last 6 months. And we raised 2 rounds of funding from a good bunch of investors, including Vulcan Capital, which is Microsoft co-founder Paul Allen's fund, 3 billionaires families, East Ventures, which is the largest Indonesia-based VC, and also angel investors like Kalyan Krishnamurti from Flipkart, Wudan founder Sujit, and also a couple of billionaire families based out of Singapore. So we are. That's how we. Some backstory of my entrepreneurship journey and where we are. Hopefully, some use sharing that. So what I'll do is that I have, as I mentioned, I'll have 15, 16 slides. So I'll just take you through the slides. Where the first 3 slides, I'll take it, then Vikram, and then Prachi, various aspects of ESOPs, and then we'll take it from there for the Q&A. Okay. I think Shweta has made the introduction about the profile of the speakers. I'll skip this.
Yeah.
Just that, in.
Do you want to make it full screen? Control L.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's better.
Right. Yes.
Okay. So this is just continuation of what I was earlier saying. What is the problem? Various, how people are bringing digitization, and platforms like Capita and others are bringing digitization in Capita and ESOP. I'll just cover it through 3 slides, and then we'll delve deep into the ESOPs. The problem is that the private markets in this region need rails. Where, just to show how the private markets differ from the public markets, in the public markets, the equity instruments are very simple. Everyone holds the same instrument. Whereas in private markets, the instruments are quite complex. their multiple preference shares, ESOPs, and sophisticated cap tables. But the ownership is only seen on the spreadsheets. Whereas in terms of systems of record, in public markets is digital. Whereas in private markets, it's paper certificates, ESOPs are managed on an Excel sheets. Companies remain private for almost 10 to 15 years, and time to IPO or acquisition is 14 years. But the ownership, there are no systems to manage that. Most important, employee liquidity. The employees get ESOPs, which are typically for vesting is for 4 years, but the company remains private for 14 years, 10 years, as I mentioned. Employees don't see the value in ESOPs because they don't know what is the value of the ESOP. There's no proper communication of the value. Even if I want to sell, there's no liquidity in the markets. Whereas if you are an employee of a Infosys or a Facebook or in a Adobe, you have full liquidity. Whereas if you are an employee of a private company, whether it is Flipkart or whether it is Paytm, which are now going for an IPO, there's no liquidity. But companies are competing for the same talent. If I have an option, I better join a company which has liquidity rather than join a private company. So it's desperate need to provide liquidity for the ESOPs. The transactions, coming to the transactions. In public markets, you can sell at any point of time, but in private markets, it's full of, if the records itself are full or on paper-based, then the transaction is full of friction. There's no electronification there. And if you look at the other side, there's a lot of demand for investors who want to invest in private markets. Just to give an idea of the size of the market, the private market in India is now around $350 billion. Size of the private markets in Southeast Asia is 100 to 150. So it's, as of now, it's $500 billion. Size of the private market in India is actually larger than the public markets. And we expect that to be $1 trillion. And this $1 trillion value, out of, if you take 10% as ESOP, that will be $100 billion of ESOP without stuck in the market, without any liquidity and lot of friction. And if you take the early investors, there's something like $200 to $250 billion of value stuck without liquidity, including ESOPs. So what is our capital vision, or what we are trying to do is that we serve the private markets, which are founders, employees, and stakeholders. We take software approach with multiple service overlays, and we are bringing digitization in equity, whether it's cap tables, ESOPs, or digital shares. And then create an operating system, which is bringing in marketplace for exchange of ESOPs and also for the shares. This is just to give you a quick roadmap so that you understand how we are bringing digitization in the ESOPs and in the shares. What we have built is a software layer first, which is cap table management and ESOP management. With digitization of the shares, ESOP liquidity, we are building the ESOP liquidity module, board and stakeholder management, and a fund admin module. This is a various software modules serving different needs. Through this, we are tying up with several startups, various investors, board members, law firms, company secretaries. And then we are enabling digitally enabled services like valuation, investor relation, but with ultimate aspiration is to provide liquidity, which is through providing something like an ESOP bank or provide intra-cap table liquidity to the ESOP holders, or bring external investors to buy ESOP employees and provide structured liquidity. Like what we are ultimate aspiration is that where we work with the company and we provide structured liquidity where employees can sell every year some of their ESOPs to the existing investors on the cap table or to the new investors. That sort of liquidity we want to provide, and we want to bring the investors to provide that liquidity. We want to bring similar liquidity what you have in public markets to the private markets. Is that what we are trying to work towards? This is just a quick roadmap. I'll go through the Vikram and Prachi will go through the details of the ESOP. Let me stop sharing here.
Sure. Thanks, Lakshman. I'll just share my screen and take over from you. Yeah, hopefully my screen is visible.
Yes.
Hi, everyone. Vikram here. Pleasure to address this August gathering. Before we begin to reimagine ESOPs, I thought maybe we cover a little bit of imagining ESOPs itself. So just starting from the basics, what is an actual ESOP? It's an opportunity for employees. It's an option, not an obligation, to purchase the shares of the employer, in this case, at a defined price, called the strike price.
And this option again, is not granted immediately. It is sort of accrued over a period of time called the vesting period, over percentages over this period of time. So at any point of time, the value of ESOPs, which an employee holds, can just be the fair market value of the shares as on date less the strike price. So that's, let's say the corporate finance definition of an ESOP. Now, why do we feel that this is a large market? Why is this relevant? Lakshman may have given you a sense already. But just tracking 70 unicorns, companies valued at greater than $1 billion across India and Southeast Asia, we see that the market capitalization with these companies is in the region of almost $500 billion. And even if I assume 10% of these companies are held by employees, that represents a $45 billion opportunity, which is effectively wealth creation for these employees who have sort of scaled and built these startups. But like Lakshman said, there is an issue of liquidity and there's an issue of managing and communicating this value to the employees. So that's why at some level we do what we do. Why are ESOPs very relevant for startups and for founders at an early stage, especially at an early stage? You align incentives with value creation. So rather than paying out cash or even paying a variable salary, at some level, induce the employees to think long term and think along with the founders in terms of building out the company over 3, 4, 5 years and beyond. ESOPs definitely help in driving entrepreneurial behavior. We want the employees to behave like owners of the company, which they actually will be if you grant them ESOPs. And it's an opportunity for employees to participate in the upside because everyone works hard at startups and they build, scale the company, and the pace of value creation at startups is very, very steep. So this is an opportunity for founders to share some of that upside, which they are getting, which their investors are getting with employees as well. You've all seen the numbers, $45 billion of value creation without any capital being invested, purely on the basis of effort invested by these employees. So it's a very, very important wealth creation tool for employees at startups as well. And coming to the more financial aspect, it's a very useful tool for early stage startups to conserve cash. There is no way early stage startups can compete with larger startups. So if I'm part of a tech startup, how do I attract engineers or developers from Google and Microsoft, given that their large companies have bigger, sort of pools of capital and are listed as well? How do I compete with them? And the answer is through ESOPs, to allow the employees to participate in the larger upside story, but take a 3 or 4 year view rather than thinking about his yearly paycheck. And finally, it's a tool for employee retention as well. Like I said, typically you grant these ESOPs and have it vest over a period of time. So it is a signal to employees to say, this is something which will have a lot of value if you take a long-term view in our company. Even if people are not completely sold on the concept of ESOPs, if any startup is going in for external equity, this becomes a rule. Because in most cases, as the first round of external funding sort of takes place, your investors will tell you to create an ESOP pool and grant ESOPs. Because investors are of the view that you can't create a world-class startup without sharing ownership with employees. But having said that, at least as far as India is concerned, and I'm sure part of it will be replicated in Singapore and other markets in Southeast Asia as well. There have been some frictions in the adoption of ESOPs. So if I were to just run through some of the key reasons which we have seen in the market, there's a perceived complexity in terms of setting up and administering an ESOP scheme. A lot of founders, especially from the non-financial side, find it to be fairly daunting. There are a lot of jargon involved here, vesting, grant, exercise, etc. And there's a certain cost in terms of drafting a scheme and getting it set up. So that's something which we are playing a role in terms of demystifying it and in terms of making the whole process simpler. There's been a fairly limited track record of wealth creation. If I were to, let's say take 2 years back, and if I were to think through on how many people actually made like reasonable fortunes with ESOPs, not too many examples come to mind. But we see that situation changing very, very quickly. The whole concept of ESOP buyback and ESOP liquidity were unknown until a year and a half back. But post-pandemic, a lot of startups have, initially they were forced to cut salaries, employees made sacrifices. And the startups basically rewarded the people who stuck on with them by announcing liquidity programs. So we have been tracking at least 40 to 45 different instances of ESOP liquidity across India and Southeast Asia. And this is something which we feel will definitely pick up momentum. So that's one element of it, why so far we have seen resistance to adoption of ESOPs. There's also an issue from a motivation perspective. Employees don't seem to understand or perceive value in the ESOPs. But this again is something which is in a large part owing to the poor communication of events of vesting, how ESOPs work, as well as the value of ESOPs to employees, which is what we are hoping to change with Capita. But that's one reason why employees are not as motivated by ESOPs, and that spills over into companies and founders as well. Liquidity is another thing. So I may be having an element of a very valuable asset in the form of my ESOPs, but if I can't monetize it, what else do I do with this asset? Which is where this still continues to be a problem. But like I said, there are more ESOP buybacks. People are starting to think of ESOP liquidity as a must-have and not a nice-to-have. And we are playing a role here as well. The taxation regime could be one more reason why ESOPs are not as I would say widely adopted. And we would, as far as India or even Singapore is concerned, I think some relaxations for startups could really go in developing the ecosystem. Because currently the way the law stands is that there is a taxation impact once employees exercise their shares. Which may in an unlisted company sort of situation, there may not be a ready market for these shares, but there's a tax impact for employees when they exercise. So if there are some relaxations which can sort of come through here, then I think that'll go a long way in developing the startup ecosystem. And let's say the final thing is more of a traditional mentality among founders. I would say maybe especially Indian founders. It's a reluctance to share ownership and a feeling of a loss of control if employees become shareholders. So at least in some instances, we have heard founders saying that, if too much of a percentage goes to my employees, what will happen? Will they raise questions? Will they sort of demand an exit and things like that? This again, I think, there are standard market practices for these ESOPs, which, if they are followed, the market is mature enough and employees are also mature enough to understand what they can do and they cannot do by holding an ESOP. So we see this changing as well. So I would say, from let's say 5 years back to today, there has been a significant change in the thinking regarding ESOPs as when it comes to both founders as well as employees. And I think the role which companies like us play, we also help in reducing these frictions and making it more and more accessible. So I'll just turn it over to Prachi right now to just talk about ESOP administration. So let me stop sharing. Over to you, Prachi.
Thanks, Vikram. Let me just share my screen. So continuing what Vikram mentioned, companies, particularly unlisted companies, it is very critical or important for them to grant options to their employees in order to ensure that they could get good talent. And so once options are granted the founders are convinced that options are granted, then the ESOPs will have a life cycle of its own. The first being that there will have to be an ESOP plan or an ESOP scheme document that is created, which is typically a scheme where you would actually list all the high level terms of what will happen in your ESOP in your ESOP plan. So it's a policy document where the terms of vesting, how is the vesting going to happen, how are you going to be pricing your options, or what's the exercise price going to be, when can employees exercise their options, so what is the exercise period of options, what happens when employees actually leave the company, so what are the separation rules that need to be documented in your ESOP plan. So one of the most critical aspects of formulating an ESOP will be on how you actually formulate the ESOP scheme document. That is where how do you actually particularly for an unlisted company, how do you document rules pertaining to liquidity of options, and this becomes very critical when there is an exit event. We've seen cases where just because the ESOP scheme document was not correctly formulated, employees could not participate in a liquidity event, and the founders actually exited, but employees were not able to exit and make money out of the ESOP. So an ESOP scheme document is the most critical part of of the entire ESOP process. So once the ESOP scheme document in place, that's like, you know, the basis where you actually then start granting options to your employees or to option grantees. In India, you can only grant to employees. In Singapore, you have the flexibility to even grant ESOPs to your consultants or advisors as well. So so once an ESOP scheme is formulated, you take a board approval at the time of an ESOP grant, and then you grant options to employees. So in a typical process, it would be like, you know, where you actually issue a grant letter, a physical grant letter to your employees, and like, you know, it sometimes is just lost. Employees don't really know, like, you know, you communicate to the employees at, like, you know, some end of the year, what is the value of options. Sometimes companies don't even do that. Like, you know, it's just a letter that is given. There is no communication that happens later on. Sometimes employees don't even know what is the value of options. They leave the company. They don't know that they, like, you know, what happens to their options. So this entire process, once the options are granted to the employees, or during the process when options are granted to the end stage, like, you know, when the employees actually get money, is what we handle on the Capita platform. So like, you know, typical process, like, you know, particularly if you consider it's a paper-based process, it's not handled through an application, is where a physical letter is given to an employee. The employee may sign it and give it back to the company. You forget about it. Vesting happens at a certain frequency, could be a yearly frequency. Usually when it's paper-based, like, you know, it's a big hassle for companies to actually track the vesting schedule. So then usually, like, you know, there's a yearly vesting schedule. Whenever like, you know, employees want to exercise it, they will actually write in a form and send it to the company, and company would issue shares. So the user engagement or the employee engagement part, like, you know, is kind of missing in this entire process, and that is what we want to actually automate. So on our application, like, you know, once the company decides that there is a grant to be given to employees, they can actually record a grant, and it can, from the application, an email can be sent for approving these options. So an approval can be taken on the system where, like, you know, a record and visually appealing kind of record gets created. You see how the vesting schedule is, how the movement of the options is going to be, and then it is sent to the board for approval through the application. Once the board approves it, an email is also triggered to the employee, where the employee can then log in, accept the grant. That is a very important process. A lot of cases we've seen that companies don't, or earlier, they never used to take an acceptance of grant, like, you know, when a grant letter was issued, could in some cases lead to litigation as well. So taking an acceptance on the grant is an important step of this entire process, which can also be automated on our platform. We are also looking to build an e-sign integration on the platform as well. So once options are granted, they would vest over a specific vesting schedule. So there could be, like, you know, a 4-year vesting schedule. It could be, like, you know, vesting equally over a period of 4 years, or it could be a varied vesting schedule. Say at the end of 1 year, 30% of your options could vest, and then it could vest equally. So that the vesting schedule can then be decided by the company. And it could be, like, you know, basis, like, you know, it could be different for different employees as well. When you're actually managing it on a platform where the vesting is automated, you don't really manually have to, like, you know, vest your options and, like, you know, track who gets how many options at, like, you know, end of a period. It's easy to, like, you know, have a more aggressive vesting schedule as well. Like, you know, it could be a monthly vesting schedule also. So that, like, you know, the employees actually see the value, like, you know, month on month, they're getting some number of options as well, right? So on the application, typically at the end of the vesting period, when options vest, an email is triggered to the option grantees, and they know that those so many options have got vested. We also have a concept of equity payslip, which can be triggered at the end of every month or every quarter based on how active the plan is. Where we can communicate what is the number of options that have got vested during this period, or, like, you know, what is the value of your options, which is the most important piece that that is, like, you know, usually missing in this whole ESOP engagement part, where companies don't necessarily communicate with the employees on what the value of their options is. And that's the piece that, like, you know, we're trying to solve with this equity payslip, where the value of options can be communicated to the employees. In some cases, like, you know, it could be a very sizable amount, particularly where there is funding, where there are, like, you know, multiple funding rounds happen, the employee's been with you for a very long time. This value could really be very high and needs to be, like, you know, communicated to the employees. They need to see the value of the options. Otherwise, it's like, you know, just a paper certificate lying somewhere. So, like, you know, from the product perspective, the equity payslip can really help in, like, you know, building this user engagement between the employees and the company. And of course, the most important step in this entire process is when the employees can actually exercise their options. So in case of a listed company, like Vikram mentioned, like, you know, there is an exit available. Employees can exercise any point of time after the vesting and can sell their shares as well. In the case of an unlisted company, there could be some restrictions. In some cases, companies may allow exercise of options so that like, you know, the employees will hold shares of the company. In some cases, the exercise could be actually linked to a liquidity event. So instead of exercising, like, you know, options immediately after vesting, it could like, you know, be directly linked to a liquidity event so that the employee doesn't have to exercise and hold on to the shares, particularly because when they are exercising, there'll be some cash outflow or, like, you know, some money that will have to be paid by the employees to exercise towards the exercise amount, towards the tax as well. So, like, you know, this entire process, though, on even exercising of options is available on the application, where the employees can just log in, they can view what is the number of options available to exercise and can exercise options online, update the payment details online. So, like, you know, there is very less, like, you know, paperwork or movement of paper or email, emails between employees in order to do these basic processes. And the most important one is the liquidity event. That is when the employee is actually going to get monetized or he's going to monetize his options. And we are building to build this piece of liquidity event where one is the employee, from an employee perspective, an employee can actually see or, like, you know, see how many options he can surrender or he can cash out. And then the second part is where we actually have, like, you know, either employees selling those shares between themselves, or there is some investor who can actually come in and, like, you know, buy shares from the employees. So typically, like, you know, if you look at the entire life cycle of an option, it would be, like, you know, start from a designing an ESOP scheme document, which is, like, you know, a more one-time kind of activity, and then, like, you know, granting ESOPs, granting options, which is, like, you know, usually done on a yearly basis. And then, like, you know, then it moving from in the life cycle, the ESOP life cycle of vesting, exercise, and then monetizing could be sale or, like, you know, basically a liquidity event happening, particularly in the case of an unlisted company. If we go on to the ESOP taxation part, so at the time of grant or vesting, there is no tax implication for an employee or for an option grantee. Tax has to be paid upon exercise. There is tax impact is on the exercise of options. And which is, like, you know, basically the difference between the fair market value of the share on the date of exercise less the strike price. This difference is then considered as a perquisite tax and taxed at the income, like, you know, as an income from salary. In Singapore, the fair market value of the share is, like, you know, the valuation has to be done by an independent valuer. In India, it has to be done by a merchant banker. So a merchant banker valuation will have to be done to actually arrive at what is the fair market value of the share. Again, it's a responsibility of the company to deduct tax. Upon sale of shares in Singapore, there is no tax implication. In India, it will be, like, you know, based on the difference between the sale price and the FMV on the exercise date, this difference will be charged as a capital gain tax. More importantly, from an employee perspective, particularly, it is important to, like, you know, for an employee to know when to exercise his options. Like, you know, the so because the longer the employee actually waits to exercise his options, he has to pay a much higher price, or he has to pay a much higher tax at the time of exercise, because the value of the company would have increased significantly, like, you know, if he waits for a longer period of time. However, if he exercises much earlier, he would, like, you know, and particularly in the case of an unlisted company, he would have paid the exercise amount. He would also have paid the tax on the exercise, but there is no liquidity for the option. So he cannot really sell them. So, like, you know, that's one thing that the employee should really consider when they decide, like, you know, when do they actually want to exercise their options, and something that needs to be, like, you know, thought through before an exercise can be done.
Prachi, sorry, one of the members is asking, what is strike price?
Yeah, so strike price is basically the exercise price. So when options are granted, they would, like, you know, they can have, in India, it has to be, like, you know, a minimum strike price is the face value of the share. In Singapore, it can be a $0. But this is the price at which, like, you know, the employee has to pay to the company to actually buy these shares. So when the options are granted to an employee, they will have a strike price. If the employee decides to exercise these options, they will actually have to pay the strike price to the company to convert these options into shares. Right, so that is the strike price. Usually in India, it is, like, you know, a minimum of face value has to be taken from them, from the option grantees. What we have seen is usually, like, you know, the options are granted at the fair market value, sometimes at a discount as well, but mostly, like, you know, at the fair market value of the share. So whatever is the valuation, it's usually granted at that. Some cases there could also be a discount given, particularly, like, you know, discounts could be given where, like, you know, maybe the first grant that the company is giving, and they want to kind of compensate employees who've been with the company for a very long time. And, like, you know, so they want that feeling to be given that when you're granting an option, at that point itself, the option has some value. In which case, like, you know, they would actually grant options at a certain discount to the fair market value. But otherwise, like, you know, it's usually granted at the fair market value. So the strike price will be the fair market value. So when employees exercise their options, they have to pay the strike price, which was decided on the date of grant. So irrespective of how much the price has increased over the period of time, they will still have to pay the strike price itself. And that is the gain that they will actually make when they exercise and they sell their options, they sell their shares. All right. And then on the ESOP accounting, so IFRS 2 is applicable, share-based payment, where the accounting is based on the fair value method. So typically on every date of grant, so if the company has granted options, like, you know, on 10 different dates, they will do a valuation of options using, like, you know, a method like Black-Scholes valuation method to calculate the fair value of the options. There are different models that are available. Black-Scholes is one of them. A lattice model is also recommended by IFRS, though not mandatory. Black-Scholes is much easier to implement. So, like, you know, mostly companies will go with the Black-Scholes model, easier to implement in terms of what are the parameters that need to be taken, considered, etc. And so Black-Scholes, like, you know, typically there are different parameters in which the valuation of options is done. So as per Black-Scholes, you have the of course, the strike price, what is the fair value of the shares. Volatility is one of the most important factors when fair value is calculated. So if we consider volatility for a listed company, it's easier to calculate the volatility over the life of the options. However, in case of an unlisted company, usually it would be a set of peer companies or comparable companies is considered who are listed, and the volatility of these companies is taken to arrive at the value of options. And this volatility is calculated over a specific period, which is called the expected life of the option. Expected life of the option is typically where it can be how long are your options going to remain remain active, or after how much period are they going to be exercised is an assumption that you would have to make to actually arrive at the expected life of the option. And based on the expected life, whatever period is there, we calculate the volatility of the options and the dividend, and then risk-free rate is also one of the parameters. So considering all of these parameters, you'd actually calculate the fair value of the options. And this fair value that is calculated is then considered to recognize the cost in your P&L. Again, to recognize the cost, there are different methods, graded vesting is the method that is recommended by IFRS, which is so the cost has to be amortized over the vesting period based on the graded method. So typically, if it's a 4-year vesting period, you would a higher portion of the cost is accounted for in the initial year. So for example, if there are 4 tranches, the cost of the first tranche plus half of the cost of the second tranche and half of the cost of the third tranche, likewise is actually booked in the first year itself. So the graded vesting, if you are following the graded vesting method, which is actually recommended by IFRS, you would actually account for almost more than 50% of your cost in the first year itself. While recognizing cost, then there are certain other parameters that have to be considered as well. One of which is the forfeiture rate. What forfeiture rate is, we estimate how many of your employees or option grantees are actually going to leave the company and their options are going to get canceled. So to that extent, you can actually reduce the cost and only book the net cost of the expected forfeitures. And then this cost is as we said, is actually booked across the vesting period. At the end of the vesting, you can also reverse the cost of unvested options canceled and basically true up that cost to make sure that you are only accounting for or only considering the cost that is applicable for options that actually have got vested. Right. And then there are disclosures that need to be given in the annual report, which is based on some specific formats are given where you have to actually give what is the number of options that are granted during the year, the weighted average exercise prices, etc. So some specific formats that are suggested, which have to be disclosed in your annual report. Vikram, maybe if you could take up the next slide on the blockchain. Sure.
Yeah, let me just share my screen. So I think there were a few questions. I've just been trying to address them on chat. Sure. If not, we'll just take it up after the presentation is over. So I think one specific area which we wanted to cover was in application of this new age blockchain digital ledger technology in what we do in terms of ESOP administration. So I think all of us will be familiar with the whole cryptocurrency boom and currently bust which is going on. While we may all have divided views when it comes to whether this is a good thing or a bad thing, I think what is critical to note is that the technology underlying crypto, blockchain or digital ledger, is something which can be applied to various other use cases which actually will add a lot of value. So your blockchain or digital ledger effectively it's storing a listing of transactions across multiple devices to ensure that it's not possible to alter any records on one device. The recording of transactions is distributed across multiple because it is distributed across multiple devices, it's an additional layer of security and eliminates a need for a person or an intermediary to sit and verify it. So that's the broad quick and dirty explanation of DLT. Digital ledger technology can be used to record and to enable transactions in anything of value. Could be real estate, could be any other asset, artwork, etc. So it has a potential potential application in ESOP administration and liquidity as well. The broad excitement around DLT is that it increases transparency, reduces transaction costs, and can help to unlock liquidity across various asset classes and also in private markets. So if I were to look at what DLT can do across the various actions when it comes to ESOP administration. So ESOP records, for example, the recording of all the grants and all the other transactions with respect to ESOPs can be stored on a distributed ledger. This eliminates a need for a custodian and eliminates a need for physical securities, because it's a secure, data and records which are stored thanks to DLT technology. ESOP administration also can be automated. There is this term called smart contracts being used, where without any manual intervention, contracts can execute, can trigger payments, can trigger events. So in the context of ESOPs, events such as vesting exercise can all be triggered, can all be recorded automatically. So this eliminates the need for, or let's say reduces the need for an ESOP administrator or a purely ESOP administrator or an intermediary to actually take these actions. And when it comes to post-exercise, in the form of liquidity and sale, the process of diligence actually gets simpler here. So with DLT technology, you can securely share information with potential buyers, and potential buyers can actually see the transaction records, can satisfy themselves that Mr. X is actually the holder of this digital ESOP, and therefore can take can proceed with the transaction. So this requires a need. This eliminates a need for people to actually verify ownership, and removes the frictions with respect to ownership or recording and verifying ownership when it comes to these ESOPs. And finally, ownership transfer in a situation like this becomes seamless. So the digital ledger actually keeps track of all transactions which have taken place, right from the time the ESOP is granted, across vesting to exercise, and finally across multiple events of sale. So this can actually make transactions faster, reduce transaction costs, and help in unlocking liquidity. So broadly, pretty much what we have as a mission at Capita, and some of the actions which we are doing today, can be done more efficiently, more seamlessly, and more securely through the application of digital ledger technology. So it is something which we are evaluating, but it is still technology at a very, very nascent stage. Requires a fair bit of understanding of mathematics and crypto to implement an actual DLT system. It is happening across the world, but we are shortly expecting to see the implications of this in ESOP administration as well. So what does it mean for us, and what do we plan to do with this? I think we are evaluating this as part of our new initiatives. And what we hope to do is effectively, as far as employees or administrators or companies are concerned, the experience will be the same in terms of seamlessly carrying through all these processes when it comes to ESOP administration, which today our digital platform is doing. But potentially our platform can be powered in the back end using digital ledger technologies, which can make it faster, which can make it far more secure, and which can deliver a similar customer experience seamlessly to any startups or any ESOP administrators. So that's where we see blockchain digital ledger playing a role in what we do. I think we have pretty much come to the end of the presentation. Maybe we can take up some of the questions which have been put up in the chat window. Lakshman, Prachi, if there's anything else, do.
I think Prachi has been answering you, and Prachi has been answering the questions in the chat.
And, if you want, we can show a 2-3 minute video of the thing, how we are automating the ESOP.
If you want to take this question, Lakshman, the questions in the chat box.
The one on Vikram, you can see that?
Yes, I'm seeing the questions. Let me just.
So there is one question on if ESOPs are underwater, will elongation of exercise period be considered as against the interest of employees as per SEBI provisions? No, it will not be considered. as against, because it's not like, you know, extending the exercise period in case ESOPs are underwater is not detrimental to the interest of the employees. It is actually in favor of the employees because they get a longer period to exercise their options since, like, you know, they are underwater. And we have seen companies extending the exercise period, particularly, like, you know, where options have been underwater and the company thinks that there can be, like, you know, the price may change. So there can be two options. One is just extending the exercise period. The other could also be doing a repricing where the exercise price is then revised and the total number of options are then revised to make sure that employees don't lose out on, like, you know, basically make some gain out of this entire ESOPs. The only point is whether you are doing repricing or you are extending the exercise period, there would be implications in terms of the accounting because it will be considered as a modification of a grant. And then you'll have to, like, you know, do a valuation, like, you know, a pre and post kind of modification valuation and book the additional cost that is applicable as well.
I think that's a question when it comes to acceleration of unvested options in a liquidity event. So broadly, I think in most ESOP schemes, this is like a standard clause. To say that in case there's a change of control or if the current founders of the company are exiting or ceding control to a new incoming investor, employees are given an option to exit. So what happens before that exit is employees are, in a lot of cases, employees are allowed to accelerate their vesting. So if any grant has been made, I'm in the middle of vesting, but there's a change of control. And with it comes all the uncertainties with respect to what the new owner will do. Will he continue with me or will he sort of replace me? Lay off employees, etc. So just more from a HR perspective to be friendly to employees, some schemes have this clause to say that if there's a change of control, we will accelerate your vesting. So we have promised you a certain quantum of ESOPs provided you stay with us for a period of time. As the founder is exiting and taking liquidity, we will allow you to take some liquidity here as well. So we'll allow you to accelerate and participate in the liquidity event. The new owner has to figure out maybe grant fresh ESOPs to the employees if they want to retain them or decide what else they want to do. So it's a clause which you have seen in quite a few ESOP schemes.
There is also one question on the cost of ESOPs to the company. Is it fixed at the time of inception or changes based on the value of options over the life of the ESOP? So typically, like, the cost of the ESOPs, employee stock options, would be fixed at the time of grant itself. So based on the valuation, the Black-Scholes value that we calculate on the date of grant, this value will then remain the same irrespective of, like, you know, how your fair market value of the share changes. So it doesn't affect the option value that you calculated on the date of grant. This is for the equity settled options. If there are options that are settled in cash, then you'll have to do the valuation, like, you know, basically market to market at every reporting period. But for ESOPs, the standard ESOPs that we have, it will be fixed on the date of grant itself.
I think we covered the questions in the chat room, I think.
Yeah, I think most of the...
I think one question to say, if just before vesting company wishes to revise the grant price, can that be done? So Prachi, maybe you can take that up.
Yeah, so nothing that stops you from doing it, but there has to be a specific reason on why you're doing it. There could be 2-3 things. If it's a listed company, you'll have to go back to your shareholders to get an approval for repricing, where you have to actually reduce the grant price. The second is, like, you know, there will be accounting implication. It will be considered as a modification of the grant, and, like, you know, you'll have to again revalue your options and take a hit into your books. In terms of an unlisted company, Also, in terms of a listed company, like, you know, if at every, like, you know, grant you're doing this for every vesting, then shareholders may not, like, you know, actually approve the repricing. Like, you know, if then, like, you know, the whole purpose of giving out options is like, you know, kind of defeated. Because, you know, you want employees to actually work towards increasing the market price of, or like, you know, the valuation of the company. And if it's not happening, then why should they gain out of an ESOP, right? When the investors are not getting out of anything out of it. So usually it's not a practice where, like, you know, a revision or a repricing is done very frequently. It's not, like, you know, looked upon very positively by and like for listed companies, investors would also not look at it in very positively.
So I think there's a question on WhatsApp, which Kalas sent me, whether accrual as per Indian tax law should be at exercise or vesting, since the value is notional at vesting, taxes on the price at exercise. Accrual should be at the time of exercise. So on that, I think, yes, taxation-wise, the impact is felt at the time of exercise. Vesting itself is not a taxable event, taxation-wise, that's how it works. But accounting, for the purpose of accounting, the cost of the ESOP compensation cost is recognized over the vesting period. So I'm just splitting the taxation and the accounting element of it. I think the second part of the question is, if exercise happens outside India, the tax should be as per the tax laws where the shares are exercised. Prachi, my understanding is that this would be, For an Indian company, the taxation would be in India. And the same for an Indian resident as well, holding ESOPs in an overseas company. In both of these cases, there will be a taxation element in India. But maybe, Prachi, you can talk about, would there be a taxation impact in the country in which the entity is sort of domiciled? So would there be some double taxation or something? Maybe that's a question.
Yeah, there could be double taxation. It will depend on the double taxation treaties that that countries would have. In some cases, there could be a case where there is double taxation.
Thanks. I think there are more questions, Prachi,
I
think Venkat Padmanabhan is asking, how do you create liquidity for these grants shares of unlisted companies? So how we intend to create liquidity is in a, there are two things, questions. One is ESOP holders and second is for the shareholders. For the ESOP holders, we want to create the liquidity in stages. First is creating a software module, like even Flipkart, right, which has now announced a share buyback of around $70-80 million share by ESOP buyback. You will be surprised that they still manage it on Google Sheets. They have a million rows to manage the ESOP in Flipkart of each grant. So what we are trying to do is first recording these ESOPs and providing a software module to automate this liquidity first. That is the first step. And second, provide liquidity with existing investors within Flipkart if they want to buy back from the employees. Provide that like the way Prachi was explaining during the her presentation. We'll provide an automate a structured process to buy back the liquidity through the system. And then if the company is open, founders are open, we will work with, we'll bring third party investors and get a company to buy back the ESOP and then sell it to the new investor. So these three ways of liquidity we want to provide, and we want to provide it in a structured manner. And then coming to the shareholders, there may be early stage investors who have invested 6-7 years back and then they're looking for liquidity. Then same thing, we can provide a structured liquidity through the system and first to the investors within the cap table. If founders are and management is comfortable, then we'll bring external investors and provide it through the system. And there is a both and create a marketplace and ultimate aspiration is we'll in Singapore, we can create a marketplace first and create ultimately an exchange. Whereas in India, it'll be more of a marketplace to bring liquidity for the shareholders. That's what we'll be creating in the next 1-2 years.
Fascinating. Thank you.
A few more questions. ESOP administration, does it include SARs? So SARs are stock appreciation rights or phantom stocks. So yes, I think the key difference here is where an ESOP scheme allows you to acquire a share at a certain price. An SAR basically tries to mimic the same financial returns, but without the involvement of shares. So an SAR, if it is like a cash settled SAR, then I link every unit of a SAR to, you know, one unit of my share, and basically tell employees that yes, you know, as the share price appreciates, you will see gain in your SAR, but we will settle it in cash. So I won't allow you to take shares. I'll just calculate the difference between FMV of my share versus your strike price and pay it to you in cash at a defined sort of time. So that's a cash settled SAR. An equity settled SAR operates very, very similar to an ESOP scheme. So when it comes to administration, yes, I think there are some small nuances with an SAR. There is a, let's say, a defined time frame for you know, paying out in cash, which, you know, our platform has to sort of contend with. But when it comes to accounting, etc., it's pretty much the same treatment. Whether I have an ESOP scheme or an SAR scheme, I will still need to record ESOP compensation cost on the difference between FMV as on every, you know, sort of reporting period less strike price. So hopefully that answers on the SAR side. Do employees have the right to vested ESOPs even after they leave the company? So this is something which is covered in your the board approved ESOP scheme. Typically, we have found that most companies will give some window, because the right way to think about it, and the, you know, the most beneficial way to the employees to think about it, is vested ESOPs are basically things which is an asset which the employee has earned. So if I, you know, in a 4-year vesting period, if I stay for 2 years, I am entitled to whatever 2 years worth of vesting of whatever shares I have. Even if I leave the company, I should still be entitled to the benefit of it. So most companies, or I would say some companies, take a very liberal view here to say that we will allow you to come back and actually exercise these shares over the next maybe 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, etc. We have also seen some companies take a, you know, fairly restrictive view to say that you have exactly 6 months or 3 months, by which time you have to take a decision or you have to come back and either exercise the shares or let your options lapse. So this is, again, a little bit, you know, sort of restrictive for the employee because of the tax reasons which we talked about, that I don't have visibility of liquidity in this company. I don't know when a liquidity event will happen. But unless I want to let my ESOPs lapse, I have to go and actually exercise and pay the tax. Over a period of time, I think there is some noise about this among the HR circles and investors as well, to say that we should be a bit liberal with employees and allow them to allow a fairly long window for even an employee who has quit to come back and exercise his vested ESOPs. Prachi, there's a question on if a listed entity is not giving any equity-based options, does it still need to comply with SEBI guidelines?
Yeah, so I think I just replied. So Companies Act also has rules for ESOPs for unlisted companies, more or less similar to the SEBI regulations. So companies would have to follow that.
So how does it work when there is a clause which says that shares can be exercised only upon liquidation or a liquidity event? So this is a common clause which we are seeing across jurisdictions, primarily to get around this problem of taxation. A lot of companies actually restrict exercise, and they tell employees that, okay, your vesting will happen. You are still entitled to the benefit of the share and the benefit of the upside in terms of the share appreciating. But we will not allow you to actually perform the action of exercise before a liquidity event, because we know that when it happens, you will need to pay a lot in terms of taxation. And at some level, we also need to go through the process of issuing a share to you. Ultimately, any employee is interested in the economic benefit of holding the ESOP. So we will deliver this benefit to you when a liquidity event happens. So you may have vested ESOPs, please hold them with you. When a liquidity event happens, when an investor, is taking secondary from employees, or when I'm, let's say, selling the company, I will allow you to then exercise, sell, and you will have the cash in hand to actually pay the tax, and you won't be out of pocket. So it's a common clause which is happening. The alternative is to allow for exercise, and in which case, the employees need to contend with tax. So I think companies do it also because employees many times don't understand the taxation impact. They might just choose to sort of go ahead and exercise and then discover that there's a large tax liability for them. The flip side of this is that, I may have the option, if exercise is not restricted, I may want to exercise my shares and hold it with me for 2 years or longer than whatever is the holding period for long-term capital gains in the jurisdiction. And then I might want to sell it and suffer a lower taxation. So that's an option which is, which won't work if you restrict exercise and only allow it upon a liquidity event. So it's always a little bit of a trade-off. But in most cases, companies feel that paying a little bit of an additional tax is still fine. But the risk of paying tax, having the shares in hand and not getting liquidity is a little bit more of a bigger pain point for employees. So that's a rationale by which some companies have it. So it's optional. Some companies actually choose to restrict exercise. Some companies actually allow exercise. So it depends from scheme to scheme. If the company has multiple series of preference shares, how does the board decide value of ESOPs? And what would that approach be acceptable to tax authorities? So the pricing on ESOPs will typically be done, on a per share basis. You will consider the fully diluted share capital. So you may have convertible securities, but the right way to think about a company is that what is my fully diluted share capital and what is the valuation and therefore what is the price per share at this point of time. So that is a benchmark for the board and for the compensation committee to set the strike price for the ESOPs. So that's how the preference shares basically get handled. From a tax authority perspective, I don't see any challenge because for them, it's basically a certain strike price and there will be a certain fair market value, again, which is calculated on a fully diluted basis. And the difference between that basically gets taxed upon exercise. So that's the approach with the tax authorities. So does this mean ordinary shares and pref shares would be valued the same? It depends on the conversion. If it's a 1:1 conversion, then effectively a pref share will be treated similar to an ordinary share. But the conversion ratio can be different as well. So when I say on a fully diluted basis, it is assuming that convertible instruments are actually converted into equity shares. So you have a common base based on their conversion ratio. So if the ratio is 1:1, then you just add equity plus pref. If the ratio is different, then it might be more than 1:1. It might be more than equity plus pref.
I think with that, we come to the end of the questions,
yeah.
Right?
Yes, I don't have any other question. There's one from, Saloni is, please, thank you.
There's one question here. So where you restricting, it's a good question. So where you're restricting exercise, then should the employee stay with the company? Not necessarily. But you will realize that, I'm part of a startup company. I move out of the startup. I still have vested ESOPs. And where you restrict exercise, typically you'll be very liberal with even your exited employees to say that, even though you have left the company, when a liquidity event happens at the company, you can always come back and participate and get the proceeds of the liquidity event. So you don't need to be with the company, but you are entitled to the proceeds of liquidation as per the ESOP scheme. The thing here is that you don't know when the liquidation will happen, when a liquidity event will happen. So that's a risk which you're running, but that's the same risk which all the other shareholders and other ESOP holders of the company are also running. So that's the way it probably works.
Vikram, there's a follow-up question from Karunav. I posted it.
Let me just see that. Yes, at the time of vesting exercise, taxes are deposited in a foreign country. Can that be considered as credit against the taxes payable at the time of sale of shares while the person is resident in India in that financial year? So Prachi, would that be credit available in case I have taxation in a foreign country?
I think so, yes.
So it would be basis the double taxation agreement, right? So
yeah,
most cases, India, Singapore, I'm sure it's available. But, again, depends on the jurisdiction.
Yeah, it will be based on the double taxation.
Okay. Great questions, and I think more than that, interesting and great answers. Thank you, everyone. With that, may I invite Pratima to share the word of thanks, please?
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Somnath. On behalf of ICICI Singapore chapter, I would like to propose vote of thanks. We would like to express our humble gratitude to all our speakers, Ms. Prachi, Mr. Lakshman, and Mr. Vikram, for taking time out and sharing their extensive knowledge, experience, and learnings on a very relevant topic of the current times. With a steady and organic growth in the startup ecosystem, tackling ESOP-related issues in a systematic manner is the need of the hour. Mr. Lakshman, it was very inspiring to hear about your entrepreneurship journey and the way Capita has grown in the last 2 years from 6 to 52 employees and completed 2 successful funding rounds. We wish you more success in all your future endeavors. We thank you, Mr. Vikram and Ms. Prachi, for taking us into the details of requirement for ESOP administration, its accounting and taxation aspects, and the potential of applying the DLT in ESOP administration for better transparency and transaction flow. So thank you very much for all the information sharing and for providing meaningful insights into this topic, and also for brilliantly answering all the queries of our member participants. Thank you. Last but not the least, a big thank you to the chapter chairman, our overseas patrons, event coordinators, and most of all, our members for their continuous support and active participation in all our chapter events. Friends, this knowledge series is organized by the members for the members. So let's keep sharing knowledge and let's make the most of this forum. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for your participation. Over to you, Somnath.
Thank you, Pratima. I have two exciting updates. One, we have more exciting events coming up in August. One is on the 5th of August on mental wellness. And the second is on the 26th of August. That's on Indian capital markets, mainly focusing on the India funds. So keep a lookout on the invitations. Secondly, we have one of our member joined today, Amit. It's his birthday. Amit.
Let's sing.
Birthday, we can sing together. Yes.
Amit Sadana and Devran. Yeah.
Where are they?
Amit joined the event today, and I don't know, he might just also, okay, let me wish them. It's okay because on this day.
I can see Amit.
Happy birthday. Yeah.
Can you switch
on? Put Amit in hold. Put Amit in hold. Put him in hold.
Pin him. We just pin him.
Pin him. Switch on his video first.
Can you switch on the video, Amit?
Come on, birthday boy. We are here.
Tell it, we start
Somnath,
because this is before.
Okay, wish you a very happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
Amit Squire.
I cannot see him.
Yeah, he did not switch on.
He's shy.
Didn't expect so much spotlight.
He's having a date with his wife, you know, very special birthday treat there.
Thank you.
Thanks, Lakshman, Vikram, and Prachi for the wonderful session, for all the answers. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah, Lakshman and Vikram, yeah, it was a very good session. It was thank really, you. Very informative. Thank you.
Thank you, Alagappan. Thank you, everyone. Thanks, thank everyone. You.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Thank you.
Good night.